Hello and welcome to Biofilm Podcast, a show that brings you to the forefront of biomedical research, biotech, pharma, and healthcare fields, and the professionals behind it. I'm your host, Pavel Rozhov. Please subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell to stay up to date. Let's get started. This is a special episode of the podcast where I was actually interviewed by Kjerstie Bourne from Elim Biopharmaceuticals and spoke with K-12 students about my scientific journey and the research I've done as part of my PhD work. I hope you enjoy this episode.
This webinar series is called Getting to Know Your Scientific Community, and it is being created and sponsored by my company, Elim Bio. Elim Bio is busy supporting researchers on the front lines. We're proud to say that we're helping scientists solve the problem of COVID-19. And during this unusual time, we wanted to reach out to feed future scientific curiosity. We felt the best way to do this is to introduce you to some of the cool scientists that are in our community. We are very honored to welcome our special helper and panelist, Dr. Pavel Rozhov. Dr. Rozhov has his PhD in biomedical sciences from Stanford Burnham Preebies Medical Discovery Institute, which is located in beautiful La Jolla, California. He has conducted life science research in two renowned institutions for over 4 years. He's been lucky to work in 4 countries and continues his quest to reach out to the world with scientific education by hosting his own YouTube channel. Dr. Rozhov has 2 publications in prestigious journals and is an expert in protein constructs, and will be explaining more about that to us. And now what we've been waiting for, Dr. Rozhov, could you tell us more about you and your research and how you enjoyed living here in La Jolla?
Hi, Kjerstie. Thank you very much for having me today. It's an honor to be here and speak to you guys. So I am originally from Russia. I was born in a fairly big city, Nizhny Novgorod. And after finishing high school, I was considering different paths to take. And I've been originally hoping to become a doctor. But especially given what's going on right now, I think I made a right choice and became a scientist. So I went to San Diego Mesa College, which is obviously in San Diego, where I obtained my associate's degree in biology and physics. I studied there for a few years. And then I transitioned to an undergraduate degree in Germany, where I then obtained my bachelor's in applied biology. In the midst of my work in this university where in Germany, I actually also did a small internship, University of Cambridge, in England, where I started to do the research that ultimately was transforming into my PhD career, which brought me back here to San Diego to SBP Medical Discovery Institute, where I recently completed my PhD journey in biomedical sciences. So it's been a kind of windy road to get to where I am now. And it was driven by and large, the curiosity for science and curiosity for what makes our organisms work on the very small level. And if you have seen the flyer for this seminar, I'm going to be talking about macromolecules, which are having many different functions in our cells, but specifically the proteins and their structure.
Wonderful. We're excited to hear more about the proteins and all your research.
Yeah. So since I was interested in proteins, let's sort of set the ground stage for what the proteins are and why they're so important to investigate. Proteins carry a large number of different functions in cells, for example, transporting even smaller molecules or catalyzing different reactions to generate energy for us. And they have multiple different roles. And studying them it can be a lifelong journey, because there is thousands, if not millions, of different proteins that have all unique functions. And they are essentially, the way they are able to do their functions is driven by and large by their structures. So what's their geometrical shape that is defining their functionality? So this was something I was curious ever since I was in middle school or high school, when I first learned about the different types of organization of protein structure. So This is what I investigated both in University of Cambridge as well as here in La Jolla, where I was essentially trying to understand how does their structure and changes in the structure affect their function. So in my PhD, I was working on specific family of proteins that regulates one of the crucial processes in cells, which is called programmed cell death. Now, this process is, from its name, essentially regulates when cells would actually die or when they're gonna continue living and dividing. And this process is very important in disease context, specifically in multiple cancers, where, if you guys may know, you have an uncontrolled cell division without cell death. So the cells don't really have a signal to actually die, and they just keep dividing and keep growing, which eventually becomes something like a tumor. So this family of proteins is what's responsible for regulating this process. And within that family, there's two types of proteins, ones that promote cell survival and sort of allow them to continue dividing. And the other one is the other type of proteins that actually cause the cell to die. So the questions that I was asking in my research have to do with what is the structure of those proteins and how does the structure of those proteins actually relate to their function? The interesting thing about these proteins is the fact that the particular protein that I investigated in is actually causing the cells to survive. And it's found in multiple different cancer settings. This is where it was originally discovered. And it's found to be in overabundance from its normal amount. If you have a lot more of that protein, you could assume and deduce that the tendency of those cells would be towards survival and propagation and obviously the cancer progression. So it's very important to investigate this type of protein. But from my perspective, as a protein structural biologist, I was very curious to find out what is the translation from the protein structure to how it actually allows the cells to survive. So specifically, that protein that I was interested in actually has another interesting aspect of it. Is if you cut a portion of that protein off, it actually changes its function completely to, instead of promoting cells to survive, to causing them to die. So this was another question that I was also trying to investigate, is what are the structural changes that this protein undergoes that allows it to switch this function completely, 180 degrees, and in which disease settings this might be important.
So, we have a question from a student.
Yeah.
We're wondering about this. You mentioned the shape of the protein. Could you explain more what that looks like?
Yeah. So all proteins essentially are comprised of amino acids, and they are interlinked together in this essentially polyamino acid chain. Now, these long chains of amino acids, they don't just exist as beads on a string, if you will. They exist in this sort of very intricate shapes, and depending on the protein, the shape of that chain of amino acids would be different. This is one of the fundamental principles of protein structure, where the sequence of those individual amino acids that comprise the length of your protein actually defines this very unique and very complex structure of the final protein. Now, that structure of the protein is super critical for this protein to be able to do what it's supposed to do. The classical example is something like a hemoglobin, the protein in our blood that is transporting oxygen and allows our cells to actually obtain the oxygen that is vital for our growth and sustainability of our organism. The shape of that molecule is unique in such a way that it allows for the oxygen to be accepted and carried and transported over. So when, for example, you have that protein misshapen, it no longer has that function, so people have diseases. And this is true for all the proteins. Their structure, this very unique three-dimensional shape that they have, defines how efficient they are in carrying out their tasks. And in what happens in diseases, by and large, these proteins may have some sort of alteration in their structure, which directly affects how they're functioning, and that's what causes a disease.
So one of the questions that a student had is, we've been talking a lot about a disease recently. Is that the same type of disease as the disease that you were studying with proteins, or is a virus different than the disease that's caused by a protein?
So the virus is essentially a small, let's call it blob of a few different macromolecules. One of them is a few different proteins that are found specifically on the surface of the virus. The specific interesting protein that, if you read about this COVID-19 virus, is called a spike protein. Now, this spike protein is a protein that allows the virus to actually attach to the cells in our body, to latch onto them and allow that virus to essentially survive and linger in our body for a long period of time. The interesting thing about what I do is, my type of research would allow one to characterize the unique structure of that type of protein on the surface of the virus and how exactly it is able to do what it's doing, which is to latch onto the cells in our body. This is one of the questions that people in other institutes have just recently uncovered. And I've been actually, as a researcher myself, I've been following that type of scientific breakthroughs as they were coming in.
Yeah, that's great, because then you can figure out how it's attaching, which would make it easier maybe to figure out how to develop something to make it not stick.
Correct. Yeah. And one of the most fascinating things to me as a researcher was the fact that previous types of coronavirus mediated diseases that we've encountered in the past had similar protein on the surface, but the shape of that protein was actually slightly different, which made the attachment of those types of viruses slightly different and had, as a result, had a completely different disease outlook because of the fact that the shape of that specific protein was slightly different. So this was so super fascinating to me as a protein scientist, that because now this virus has a slightly different shape of that protein, this is what causes it to be such a big deal and such a big problem.
Yeah, we had another question about the shape of the protein and how it attaches. They were wondering if the shape of the protein affects where it attaches within your body, or if it can just attach anywhere.
So one side of the equation for this binding of this virus to where it does in our body is driven by the spike protein that I've just mentioned. The other aspect of that is another protein which that spike protein has to connect to. Now, this other protein that we have in our body is present in different types of tissues. And this is a particular type of receptor protein, which is found on the surface of multiple different cell types in our organism, but specifically is also found in lungs, for example. This is why we find these pneumonia type diseases, because we have this receptor protein that the spike protein from the virus can connect to. So I suppose interesting question is, what is the shape of the other protein in that we have that this virus can attach to? So investigating that protein is also very critical, and how they interface would be something that is very important to investigate. And potentially as a therapeutic intervention, you could think of some kind of small molecule that can bind to one or the other that would disrupt that binding. This is one of the most promising ways you can try and treat this disease once it starts.
No, that's really cool. You think about things sticking together. I'm sure a lot of kids have played with different blocks like Legos and Kinects that fit. Yeah. Sometimes they fit together and sometimes they don't. And it's kind of alike.
It's very similar to that. This another example that we colloquially use in my field is a lock and key type principle, where the lock could be imagined as one protein, and then the key could be another protein. But the shapes of the lock and key have to be complementary to one another in order for them to actually stick to each other. Legos is another great example. Yeah.
Cool. You mentioned about how the cells can replicate and how some proteins cause tumors and cancer cells to keep replicating. Could that ever be a positive in our body, or is it always a negative when we have cell replication?
So it can be positive for sure. Anytime we have a wound and we need to repair our skin or something like that, if we have a cut, This is driven by and large by the replication of those cells, by cell division. So it's critical that you have this process in place, but it needs to be controlled. It needs to be programmed. That's why this process that I was investigating, programmed cell death, is super vital for cellular regeneration, for the growth of our cells. Like, right, as we go from a baby to an adult, this is driven by cell division. But if it's not controlled, and in maybe in specific area of our body, this is where we start to have problems. And that family of proteins that I mentioned that I'm investigating is what regulates this very fine balance. Yeah.
Yeah, it's so cool about how life is a balance and science is a balance. And we were talking about that a little bit, how everything is interconnected and one thing affects something else. And sometimes that's a good thing and sometimes it's something that maybe you don't particularly want to see happening.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's an infinite balance.
Yes, definitely. Is there anything that you were hoping to figure out in your research that you were able to accomplish or that you were wishing you had more time to work on?
Yeah, so that's a great question, because going into the PhD program, which I spent the last 3.5 years on, I had my own aspirations, my own ideas about how do I want to pursue the types of questions that I've described before. And one of the things that I've discovered is that process from where I started to where I am now, the types of questions that I had in the beginning were much more ambitious than what I was able to address. By and large, everybody really has similar experience in PhD or in research in general, because it's a journey to uncover these mysteries. And however, one thing I took away from this experience was the fact that some of the questions that I was able to address are still quite important and are able to close the very specific gaps in our understanding of these proteins that I was describing, and actually will pave the way for other people to go and continue this type of research, because it's never about one person solving everything, especially now in 21st century where we know so much. And it becomes just more and more complex. We have to rely on other people to continue what we start with and be able to realize, okay, now this is where I hand over the torch. This is what I've discovered. And I think from my perspective, I was able to answer, for example, the protein that I mentioned that I investigated primarily, I was able to address the two types of structures that this protein can have, and in two places in cells where you can find that protein, and how is the structure of that protein connected to where it is located in the cell. This was one of the questions that I was curious when I started working with that protein originally, when I first read about it, and I was able to close that gap. And the other question I was able to address is, what happens when you cut a portion of that protein off, and how does that change its function? That question was much harder to address. And I think I would say scratched the surface of answering that question. I laid the groundwork for that, but it would be up to somebody else to continue doing that research.
Yeah, I love that about science, how everything, and scientists are very good about sharing information and understanding that we are all together. And discover one thing and someone else discovers something else, and it builds upon each other.
Absolutely, yeah.
That's great. One thing you mentioned that maybe not all the students know about is amino acids. Could you explain a little bit more about amino acids and what that means and how they fit together?
Yeah. So amino acids are small. I mean, small is everything is small when we talk about proteins or cells. But amino acids are small molecules which are organic molecules, meaning they are found in living organisms. This is we have about 20 amino acids, 20 types of amino acids from which all the proteins are comprised of. So you think you have 20 different types of amino acids that you can string together on this, again, on this thing, think beads on a string type scenario, in any order that you see fit. And basically, that order and the diversity of those 20 different amino acids actually yields this specific shape of the protein, because of the way that they look, because of the way they interact with one another on that string. And this essentially allows them to create this phenomenal diversity of shapes, sizes, and things like that. But another thing I want to sort of elaborate on is the amino acids don't just come out of nowhere. We are, when we talk about amino acids and when we talk about proteins, we need to talk about another side of that coin, which is DNA, where all of our genetic information is stored. And this is how we carry the genetic information from person to person, from organism to organism. DNA actually codes for the sequence of those amino acids in the protein. And this is what allows one to replicate all those different proteins that we find in a banana or in a bacterium or anywhere else. We share a lot of those same proteins for the same tasks. Yeah, so that's just kind of my short answer.
And my company, we work a lot with peptides. Do you think you could explain, because sometimes people have heard about peptides in relation to maybe a skin cream, but that isn't what we are talking about in science. So could you explain peptides and protein and amino acid and how they all...
Yeah, so the quick answer is the amino acids can be strung up in a string. And depending on the length of the string, you can sort of differentiate roughly between peptides, which are short chains of your amino acids, and full-fledged proteins that are something like a few hundred or a few thousand amino acids long. Peptides, you would think of peptides as something between like 10 to 15 to 50 maybe amino acids long. This would be like the length of those peptides that we would be dealing with. And they're different in terms of peptides would have a simpler shape to them, and proteins are much more complex in terms of how that sort of string is sort of crumped together in this sort of knot, if you will. Yeah, peptides are a little bit easier to deal with.
Yeah, definitely. would you explain a little bit more about how they are manufactured and made? Because maybe some of the kids have heard about manufactured DNA and synthesis.
Yeah, so while I'm not an expert on exactly how peptides are manufactured per se, especially without going into too much detail, there's different ways you can go about manufacturing DNA or protein. So let's start with DNA. DNA can be manufactured. First of all, it's manufactured by all of us at this, you know, at this instant, right? We are living beings. Every cell in our body can manufacture and replicate DNA. We leverage this property of living cells to synthesize new DNA very heavily across the life science spectrum. We rely on bacteria, for example. In my laboratory, we rely on bacteria to synthesize new DNA for us. At the same time, when we talk about, say, proteins, we rely on the same bacteria to not only synthesize the DNA that we want, but that DNA would usually code for the sequence of those amino acids that we make the protein out of. So we rely again on the bacteria to actually generate and manufacture those proteins for us that we then use to study them. So we heavily rely on these organisms as those mini biological factories, if you will, for production of DNA or the proteins. If we talk about industrial scale in sort of larger quantities, there's other methods to do that that do not necessarily involve using organisms for that purpose.
Yeah. So, I mean, amazing when I think about how far things have come since I was a kid, the age of the kids that were on there. On the call, and just going into a lab is pretty awesome. All the technology that's being used is called biotech for a reason. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't understand all the AI and computer software and different technology that is input into our scientific research. Did you have any technology that you used when you were doing your research?
Yeah, definitely. The one big piece of machinery that I had to use heavily to study the actual structures of those proteins is called nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. This is a technique which allows one to obtain information about each of those amino acids in their three-dimensional position with respect to one another. So from there, you can reconstruct the final shape of that protein. Basically, this is that technology is akin to what's called magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI, which is used to take pictures or scans of your body, of your brain in particular. Usually it uses similar radio frequencies and large magnets to essentially resonate with, in my case, with the protein that I'm investigating in, because Well, not because, that's just how it works. And those are essentially super large superconducting magnets into which you put your protein sample, and then you pulse them with radio frequency waves to obtain information. That was a big piece of machinery. It's very expensive, and yes. It's quite complicated to operate.
Yes, yes. Well, I love, we study a lot of times magnets in schools, and there's so many ways that we use them that people don't really know that they are in our everyday life and affect us. Pretty great to hear about a technology that uses magnets, how important they are in our life.
That's one of the super important technologies that was discovered and continuously improved on over many decades. Advances in our understanding of how those magnets work from the physics and electronics standpoint is what allows now us to study more complex protein shapes and larger proteins. Because previously, because of the limitations of technology and our understanding of how to leverage these magnetic fields, we would not be able to go to where we are now. Another important thing that differentiates this particular technology from other ways you can study protein structures is this technology allows one to not only obtain the structure of the protein, but actually to understand how it changes as the time goes on. Because one thing that people tend to forget about proteins, which I think is super important to understand, is that these are not, when we used this Lego analogy before, but think of proteins as kind of jiggly Legos, if you will. They constantly vibrate. They constantly change their shape with respect to small changes in their environment because they need to respond very quickly to what happens. So the dynamics of the changes in that structure is something that is super critical for our more thorough understanding and how to leverage that in the disease context. This technology allows us to study the dynamics of that, not just the structure.
Yeah, that's so awesome. I love it. When you did an experiment in your lab, did it typically look like? Can you explain that to the kids a little bit more?
Yeah, so I would say the way I was told when I first joined the lab, kind of how my typical workflow and sort of work experience would look like. It would be 80% making the protein that I'm interested in and about 20% of actually analyzing it. That would be like the breakdown of the things that I had to do. So I would spend first 80% of my time using those bacteria to actually produce the protein that I want. And sometimes they're particularly happy about making that. So you have to make them do that. And maybe that sounds kind of wrong, but basically you sort of optimize how they grow, making sure that they're happy to produce this protein for you. So, and then you purify that from those bacteria. This is a large chunk of my time was spent on that optimization and protein production stage, because you need high purity samples, high quality protein samples in large quantities to be able to analyze them later.
Then what did that bacterium look like when you were trying to replicate the protein? Was it in some sort of receptacle?
This basically was, imagine a kind of a bucket of liquid, and inside that bucket of liquid, it's full of bacteria, and you shake it in an incubator at the temperature of our human body, because the bacterium that we use is called E. coli bacterium, which is found also in our gut. This is a bacterium, obviously likes the temperature of our body, so we may have to make sure that the temperature is correct, and then we essentially make it grow the protein that we want to investigate for many hours, and then we harvest those bacteria, and then we have to break them apart to extract that protein. And this is a multi-step, multi-day, sometimes multi-week process where each step has to be optimized to make sure that you get to the final point where you can actually analyze the protein. Yeah, so there's a bunch of bacteria. It's kind of nasty if you think about it, but it's very safe if you follow your safety protocols. You wear your lab coat, goggles, gloves, and things like that. So.
Oh, so you wore the same type of protective equipment that you would see maybe now at the hospital or doctor's office.
Definitely, it's very similar. The white lab coat, the goggles, the gloves, all that stuff is super important when you're handling bacteria. To be fair, they're not the ones that I worked with. They're not quite dangerous, but naturally, everybody in our institute has to wear personal protective equipment. Sometimes I would have to wear the masks that you might see on people now in the streets, like those N95 respirators. I would have to use them for handling certain hazardous chemicals. That was definitely a big part of the work that I did.
Yeah, definitely being safe.
Yeah, it's very important.
Did you do any collaboration on your research when you were...
Definitely a big part of our research has to do with collaborating with outside experts in the field. And depending on the type of question that I had to collaborate sometimes with people in my institute, sometimes with people outside. So the two, I guess, collaborations that I want to highlight was, one was actually a collaboration with the previous lab that I worked in University of Cambridge. So I actually, when I came here to San Diego, I knew that that lab that I in UK actually did similar research on similar proteins, but they used different techniques to answer similar questions about the same proteins. So when I came to San Diego, I proposed to collaborate with them to try and address a particular question that we all had and sort of use our techniques that they had, that we have, and sort of complement them and sort of compare the findings. So the other collaboration was more inside my institute. There was another professor in our institute that had a specific piece of equipment that we wanted to use to address some of the questions that we had. So we collaborated with that other professor as well. Yeah, this is just a small piece of collaboration.
I know a lot of times in schools, when students have a lab that they're doing, they collaborate with other students. So that would maybe be a true experience then of when you're a real scientist. You're actually collaborating with your peers on.
Absolutely. Yeah. There is no science without collaboration, without sharing the knowledge. And it's a big debate in our life science field for many decades, if not hundreds of years, like how much do we share with each other? And what does that look like? With advances in internet and technology, the sharing and collaboration has been much more productive now than it was ever before. So that gives me hope for the future.
Yes, definitely. Yeah, I think you reach a solution faster when you have more minds working on it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
What do you like to do when you're not working? Do you just do science all day?
So a part of... I guess if I were to elaborate a little bit on a day in the life of a scientist a little bit more, I would say by and large, it's not you standing in front of the bench and you do your experiments all day long from 9 to 5 or from 9 to 9, which can be imagined given how much stuff we need to do on a day-to-day basis. A lot of our work, it has to do with interacting with one another and just sort of to continue the conversation of collaboration, something that is not... collaborating with outside experts, but inside the laboratory. I had multiple colleagues. We have about 8 people working in the laboratory right across the bench from one another. And we all would share the ideas, ask each other questions, troubleshoot the problems that we would have on a day-to-day basis. So there's a lot of drinking coffee and talking about problems that we encounter, or just, you know, as we're doing something, we would ask each other for help or advice, or just to make sure that we're doing it in a safe and correct manner. Especially early on, I had to rely heavily on other people to tell me how to do it in a safe manner and in the correct manner. And so a lot of it is actually talking to each other, to making sure that there is transparency, there is collaboration going on, and without it, you would not be able to be a successful scientist. So that's sort of being inside a laboratory. Outside, it is... frankly, also more socializing, I guess, and maybe in a more relaxed setting when you go outside with some of my student friends or with my colleagues to go see a movie or, you know, just have lunch or dinner together where we also share some other stories and things like that. I guess for me personally, one of the things I really like to do is maybe rewatch some television. Or now I've really started doing some science education videos, and like that YouTube channel was really born out of me trying to explore how I can really educate people and educate students or young career professionals about the latest news in, you know, life science research or biotech or pharma world.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think a lot of times people imagine scientists just like sitting there doing their experiments, not talking to anybody, and they don't realize how collaborative and how we go out and communicate with everyone and work together as a team.
Yeah. Part of the reason for success for me that I found, and the reason why I'm even, I think I obtained my PhD in the first place, is by and large by the community of people that I was surrounded with. It is not an understatement that that community of people, the lab that I was in, and the larger institute-wide community, is super supportive, and you need that sort of peer system, peer support system, to become a better scientist. Frankly, you need that outside input, critical feedback that is super vital to advance your presentation skills or advance your understanding of certain harder to grasp concepts. Mm-hmm. Is absolutely essential to keep talking to people. And that's why I tend to spend, and we as scientists tend to spend long hours in the laboratory, because, you know, not just like your 8 hours or like sometimes 10 or 12 or more, because it's part collaboration. It's this conversations that you keep having, these experiments that you share, and, you know, really brainstorm. This is what gives us long days and long hours together.
Yeah, it's fun to have people that you enjoy working with too.
Absolutely, yeah, it's critical.
How did you become interested in science? Were you born interested in science, or did you meet somebody that inspired you?
So both my parents are doctors, and I have a multi-generational family of physicians in my family. I was supposed to be the fifth generation physician. So I was sort of destined to become a doctor for a long time. So when I went to my high school, it actually in Russia, the high school I went to was more geared towards medicine and sort of science type of classes, biology, chemistry, physics, things like that. And fortunately, now I think it's fortunately that I pivoted from staying in Russia and going to medical academy right from the high school. I went in more just different route. I went to community college, which I'm a big advocate of, going to community college instead of going to university. I think it's much more smaller groups of people. And this is where I found fantastic teachers, which I also had throughout high school, fantastic science teachers that really inspired me to just be curious about proteins. I remember vividly the lecture on protein structure. I think I was in eighth grade or ninth grade or something like that, where I was described that for the first time. And just, I was just in awe of what I saw. And gradually I started to really pivot from trying to help people actively in a safe environment, in the hospital environment, even though I had some experience doing that, closer to just thinking about, you know, the small details about cells, about proteins and things like that. And especially in the undergrad, I picked up a protein, textbook about specifically protein structures and things like that. I didn't have any class on that. I found it and I started reading it. I was super interested in that. I'm very passionate about learning more about it. And this is what inspired me to pursue this internship in a different country in UK, because at the time I was in Germany, to try and find this lab that would allow me to pursue this passion. And obviously I pursued it in my PhD as well. So I think by and large, the curiosity was the driving factor, because I think I had phenomenal teachers. And if you don't have by any chance the great teachers that can teach you biology or chemistry, don't give up on that science, because I think it's vital to just try and find somebody who can really tell you how fascinating it is. So I was very lucky.
That's great. And there's a lot of the students are home a lot more now, and they maybe have a little bit more extra time because they don't have their sports and activities. So if they have something they can look at, there's a lot of online sources to feed that curiosity.
Absolutely. Even up until now, I rely on online sources to sometimes even YouTube videos to learn some concepts, refresh some concepts, or for more scientifically, for more professional scientific community, there is lots of different resources where you can access articles, research articles and review articles and things like that. It's a vast collection of knowledge that you can tap into.
Yeah, I love the internet. It's awesome. You mentioned when you were growing up a little bit about how things were, but I'm sure kids are curious about how your life was when you were growing up in Russia. How is it different maybe from what you see or have witnessed kids here?
Yeah, I was I was always very busy. I was always very busy. I had lots of extracurricular activities. I used to dance actually quite a bit back when I was growing up. But from the high school on, from the eighth grade, we don't have a 12th grade. Our high school is from 8th to 11th. So for 4 years, I transitioned into that specific high school where it was large focus on biology and chemistry and medically oriented classes. So I had a huge workload of classes that I had to do. I took all the extracurriculars I could find on chemistry and biology. I was just consuming knowledge constantly. And that was difficult, you know, by no means. I'm not going to sugarcoat that it was difficult to try and cram everything in that tiny brain at the time and really try and sort of keep everything together. But I think it was fundamentally crucial to keep staying busy, to always find yourself to do something. And when it comes to science, there's no shortage of things you can really look and learn about. But I think it's also important to maintain a good network of friends that are equally minded, and also to try and find somebody to look up to, try and find some either science teachers or people whom you may know through your friends or family that you can ask them questions about what drove them to science and things like that. And picking a path for yourself, especially if you want to be a scientist, it would come eventually. Don't try and make a decision on, oh, I want to be a scientist, because that stuff changes over time. I wanted to be a dentist up until 10th grade, and I am now not a dentist by no means, like, even though my parents would probably want me to be one or something, right? It's okay to reserve your choice who you want to be, but it's important maybe to sort of narrow down on the field and sort of on the passion that you have. That's what helped me in those early years.
Definitely. Well, Dan, you mentioned having a role model or hero. Do you have a role model or hero that you?
Yeah. So I think there are a couple of role models. I think it's okay to have multiple role models for different things in your life. For hardworking, like one of the most hardworking people I know is my dad. He's a head of the surgery department. So he was almost never really home. He would spend days on end at work, just, you know, making sure patients are safe. So to me, hard working comes from him and just being absolutely just dedicated to serving others. But that at the same time, I realize, okay, he's doing his surgery stuff, but I'm passionate about science and technology and things like that. One of the people I not like look up to, but I think I gravitated towards, especially when I was in high school, is Tony Stark, right? Tony Stark is absolutely, you know, phenomenal scientist, actually, first and foremost. He has a phenomenal brain. And so I naturally gravitated towards the coolness of, like, his persona of being that cool scientist too, growing up. But also from just purely scientific, biological, or chemical point of view, I was inspired by the teachers that I had both in high school, in college, or in university. And I just saw them as people who have knowledge and who have passion for educating others. Another thing is science education is a big component of who I am. So my role models was actually both of my grandmothers, who are both teachers. So, and as well as many other different teachers that I had throughout the year. So I had multiple different role models, and I picked sort of what I found the most important for me from them. So it's okay to have multiple and just keep looking for more. Yeah.
Yeah, I love it. Find the things that inspire you from each person.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Oh, yeah, good. And then you did mention that you spent a lot of time seeking out your own information and just being curious.
Yeah.
That the kids can do that a lot. And I just wanted to highlight that because now they have more time to do that. And it's a big part of science education, just being curious.
Yeah, absolutely. I recently wrote a short article on that. Not to brag, it's just like something I really was thinking a lot about. And that article title, it's not really published anywhere, but it's called Power of Being Curious. I think what drives us as humans and what's driven us for thousands of years is us being curious about what happens in our world. How do our organisms work on an organism, on a cellular level, or on a protein level? All those things, we know now is because somebody at some point was curious about it and went out and actually tested something. This is the most important fundamental thing to be human, in my opinion, is to remain curious.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, being curious is super important. But we really appreciate your time, Dr. Ritchcock, and we really liked getting to know you and more about your research and your path in becoming a scientist.
Yeah,
thank you.